Hello, I'm Bill O'Donnell, and welcome back to a second part of our interview with Brother Aquinas of Christ in the Desert Monastery in Abiquiu, New Mexico. If you missed the previous segment, we'll recap a little bit of it for you. But anyhow, welcome back, Brother Aquinas.
Thank you.
Brother Aquinas came to New Mexico to be a hermit under the Archbishop, and then later became more closely associated with Christ in the Desert Monastery, and was very instrumental in helping that monastery sort of move into the third millennium with helping develop their website. And as the tradition of monastic living tells us, they were at the forefront of technology of their time, and now we're back to the same thing, or forward to the same thing.
Yes.
Of being at the forefront. A lot of people just don't think in terms of monks and technology, but in reality, that's where they've been, always in the forefront of technology, haven't they?
Yes, it's true. It's been throughout the history of monasticism. Monks have always been in medicine, architecture, everything.
For those of you who don't know anything about monks or a monastery, give us a little insight as to what that is.
Well, I think what monasticism is about is really focusing yourself. It's a specialization. And what it is really, it's a specialization on love, really to focus on loving God and neighbor in a mystical sense, in a way that is a union with God that allows God to enter the world to help others. I mean, sometimes it's really the highest vocation because it's the gateway. What monks do is the gateway through which the Holy Spirit comes into the world. And that's really what monasteries are for, and that's why people become monks.
Mm. Well, it sounds certainly different than what you see out in the world, typically. There's not much of that out there, or so it would seem.
Yes, well, I mean, our monastery is very primitive, and it's more primitive than most. And, you know, we're 13 miles down a horrible dirt road, and until very recently we had no electricity or phone lines or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, the whole day is based on a schedule of prayer and sort of very simple work just to maintain the community, cooking and chopping wood, and in addition to the computer work, yes.
Yeah. Tell us a little, just a background, again, if people missed that first part where we introduced you, tell us a little bit about your background. A lot of people don't know that you're a convert, that you got your call to the faith through studying philosophy at Thomas
Yes.
Aquinas in California, and that led you in this direction. That's a phenomenal story in and of itself. I mean, to be a convert to the faith must have taken a lot of faith.
Yes, and it did. And you know, I think for me, and I think it's the case for a lot of people, people see God and understand what God is, but they don't see in the world or necessarily in religion that those people are talking about what I see in my heart. And I think for me that was the case, that what I saw in religion was not what I saw in my heart of the truth of being. And it was later in college, studying at Thomas Aquinas College, which is a great books college, that I came to see that what in the depths of the Catholic tradition philosophically, in Augustine and Aquinas and others, that what they're talking about was what I saw in my heart, and that's what led me to the Catholic faith.
Yeah. But not being raised any religion
of
any kind, I think, you know, it's amazing. How did you find your way even to Thomas Aquinas, or what was it that drew you? And of all the Christian denominations out there, how did you choose Catholicism?
Well, I was very interested in education and liberal education, and the whole idea that education, the classical sense of liberal education, that by coming to know what's true, that frees you, and that's the key to what a free human life is about. And so I looked first at St. John's College, and that was really what led me. And then, as we mentioned last week, I spoke or was speaking with the two colleges, Thomas Aquinas College and St. John's, and I discovered there was a real difference in the approach, that at Thomas Aquinas College, they believed that there was a truth that was knowable. Whereas at St. John's, it's a much more skeptical, philosophical approach. Mm-hmm. And so without being Catholic, with really being against religion, but just on that sort of philosophical tenet of what education is, I went to Thomas Aquinas College.
Mm-hmm. And the rest is history. And then you, I understand you approached the Carthusians at one point to further your vocation or to become more closer to God in that sense. Is that right?
Yes. No, I mean, I think when I first became Catholic, I immediately had the vocation to solitude and into the monastic life. And so I first went to the Carthusians, and of course I was freshly baptized, and any wise monastic order doesn't accept, you know, enthusiastic, freshly baptized people. So they asked me to take some time and to come back in a year. But it was during that sort of period of discernment that I decided I needed a more radical kind of solitude, and that's what led me to Christ in the Desert.
Mm. And so at that time, then you spent several years across the river from the monastery and lived in isolation, except that you could come over and join them for prayer when you felt a call and that sort of thing?
Yeah, that's right. I lived alone as much as possible. There was necessary contact to get food and water and for mass and that sort of thing. But basically, it was just leading an eremitic life of prayer and work in the solitude.
Modernly, I guess the most famous monk of our time is Thomas Merton and his desire to go to a hermitage. Did any of his works inspire you, or were you familiar with him?
Yeah, many of his works are wonderful. Yeah, he's an extraordinary writer. Yeah.
But your draw to become a hermit, I don't think many people understand what that's about and what is the benefit. Tell us the benefit. I mean, they can imagine the hardship of being alone and the rest of it. Can you share some of the joy of that solitude?
Yeah, well, you know, I think that the key to any monastic life and to the solitary life is that it's an absolute specialization. You want to focus on the prayer and on loving God and neighbor singly without any other occupations. And that's really the whole purpose of the solitude is to free you from any other distractions so that you can love exclusively. And that's really what it was about. And it's a matter, you know, in a lot of the desert fathers and people, they talk about, you know, the battles and all that. And it really becomes a battle within the self to detach from attachments to the world so that you can be free to love. And so that's... The solitude is really a battle, and I think that's the whole monastic life. It's this interior battle to free yourself to love. And that's, there's really an experience of being very close to God when that happens. It's sort of, in some sense, it's extremes. On the one hand, it's extraordinarily difficult because you really face your disordered attachments and your sin very directly. But at the same time, because you face them so directly, you have to detach from them, and when you make that detachment, it really frees you to come very close to God. So there is something wonderful about the solitude and monasteries. Yeah,
and it led you to that next phase with working together with then Prior Philip, now Abbot Philip of Christ Center Monastery. The two of you and others, I suspect, got together and decided there was something more needed to be done, and you ended up. How'd you make that leap from hermitage to developing a scriptorium for a monastery?
The whole process started very slowly, and I was living in my complete solitude, and the monks were having financial problems. They had to figure out how to support themselves with all these new brothers who were coming to become monks. And just from a practical sense, because they were in the middle of nowhere, the idea came up that they should use computers to support themselves because they could adapt it to their schedule and do it out there. But they needed some help technically to get things started. And so I went over, just for a short period, the idea was I would just go over and help set up the network and then return to my hermitage. And so we did some of that. And then it happened, we began doing with the computers data entry originally. And I helped set up that network and spent a couple months doing that and then went back to the hermitage. But it happened in the community that this data entry work was really, it's a horribly inhuman work. I mean, it just dulls the senses. And monasticism is not about that. Monasticism is about becoming a fully human person. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't good. And so we had to find some other work. Mm-hmm. And it was at that time, we're not even sure where we heard about the web, Time Magazine or something. But the minute I heard about the web, it struck me that this was something extraordinary. It had deep implications for the church and for our community. And I spoke with our Abbot Philip, and he immediately grasped the importance of it too. And I mean, there are several things that sort of grasped us at once. One was that we could use the technology to make a living, and it wouldn't be a dull work. It would be a very creative work. We could use all the talents of the brothers. We could use our engineers, our artists, our writers, people who had editing experience. And so it would really engage the whole creative person. And the other thing that really, really intrigued us with the web was that it would be this return to the ancient monastic tradition of illumination. Because really what monks used to do when they would take a text, scripture, or one of the writings of the fathers of the church, they would take that text and then they would illuminate it, you know, with gold leaf and inks and paint. And what they were really doing was taking those words and the ideas and illuminating them to the whole person. So it wasn't just words, it was this beauty that would affect people. Mm. And what we saw on the web was an ability to return to that. Because what the printing press had done was eliminate the ability to illuminate. words became just typeset words, very cold and sterile. They didn't engage the whole person. Mm-hmm. The web is really a way that lets us return to a much more fully human expression of ideas.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think this is a good time right now to let's show a little piece. We're fortunate to have a piece that was done a few years ago by ABC World News Tonight that gives us an insight of what Christ in the Desert is all about and what Brother Aquinas is talking about, this conversion of life, in effect. I mean, they still had the monastic life going, but then to add in this new technology and see what happens. So sit back at home, but as we get ready to do that, be sure and get yourself a pencil and a paper. There's going to be some information, the credits at the end of the show, to let you know where you can get further information or to go to the web yourself and to punch up and find nextscribe.org or Christ in the Desert Monastery on the web. Anyhow, sit back and watch this 3-minute piece from ABC World News Tonight.
Finally this evening from us, modernizing the mission. When the Order of Saint Benedict was founded 1400 years ago to preserve and pass along the wisdom of the church, it was considered to be just a little ahead of its time. ABC's Dean Reynolds has now come upon another Benedictine monastery, once again, just a little bit ahead of its time.
At Christ in the Desert Monastery, the monks are hard at prayer. 24 men from the Order of Saint Benedict devoting their lives to worship. And yet, this monastery is like no other. The brothers here are running a $200,000 business, designing websites for internet customers around the world.
We wanted to find a kind of work that would be more creative and human.
Some brothers would have preferred a more traditional factory, but the computer idea won out after overcoming some initial obstacles.
Well, our oldest brother here, when we started doing the internet, he said, "Bro, there's pornography there."
Yeah.
And I said, "Bro, you can go down to the corner store and buy a booklet."
Brother Aquinas is a former hermit who runs what the monastery calls its scriptorium.
The first thing we did was just to build our own site, and so that we would have that as an example of the kind of work that we can do. The chant is the most popular section. People told us they find it very refreshing and sort of peaceful and, you know, amidst all the noise that's on the web.
Word of the cyber monks reached the Vatican, and now with some equipment donated by Microsoft, the brothers are designing web pages for the Pope, downloading the entire library of the Holy See. Just as their predecessors preserved and highlighted scriptures for centuries, so today these monks are using their artwork to illustrate such things as papal encyclicals.
Well, sometimes I laugh because, you know, it's this little piece that I've done or top of my bed becomes something that many people may look at or admire. Sometimes I laugh.
The monastery was founded here in 1964 by 4 or 5 monks who were just looking for a quiet place to pray. No. Today, no, there are cell phones and solar panels, plus a $1 million housing expansion.
I could not have imagined this had I set out 10 years ago and say, what would the future be?
Their computer skills have enabled the monks to continue pursuing their vocation, to glorify God and assist their fellow man through their work and their prayers. Reynolds, ABC News in northern New Mexico.
Another extraordinary piece, brother. Thanks for bringing that to us.
Yes.
I think you got a chance to see that at home. That was a piece that World News Tonight with Peter Jennings did a few years ago, and it kind of gives a sense of what the life at the monastery is, but now how it's changed dramatically with the advent of technology and applying and leading in this field once again.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
So tell us about what now. It sounds like this process is still continuing. You're being led yet further in a different direction. You're no longer a hermit. You're out building, going to be building community. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yes. And as I mentioned in I think last week, really when we became involved with the web and all this, and then became involved with the Vatican, we really began to think about not just the monastery and making money for ourselves, but what the technology meant for the church as a whole and really for humanity and for the process of God sanctifying people on earth. And we began this whole search throughout the church to find an institution that could do what we thought needed to be done. And we didn't find another institution, so it really came back to us. And we then began to think, well, how can the monastery do what needs to be done for the church, to bring God into the world using this technology? It became clear that the monastery itself, as a contemplative monastery, if it tried to do this, it would destroy its contemplative nature. So we had to develop a daughter project, and the daughter project we're working on is this next scribe project in the Scribes of St. Peter. And really, you know, the objective of what we're trying to do with this, as I say, is to bring God's word into the world using the new technologies. And to understand why that's important, I think you really have to understand that this technology is not just a different kind of, it's not the same kind of medium, it's just a new way of doing it. It's an entirely different way of expression between people.
How is it different from, say, television or radio or the telephone?
Yeah, and when you look at the broadcast media, you take one person's expression or one expression and you give it to a million people. Well, there's nothing personal about that. And it's the nature of the faith that it's extremely personal. When God speaks to the heart, and then when people try to express God's word between each other, from heart to heart, you can't do that from one to millions. That's a very sort of intimate kind of communication. Well, the difference between the new technology, the web and all of that, and radio and television, the broadcast media, is that with the new technology, you can individualize an expression. You can take an expression of God's word and adapt it to the individual person. So in some way, on a mass scale, you can express God's word with the intimacy of a spiritual advisor. And a lot of that involves being able to program content. So and what we like to think of it is if you're sitting down to write content, to try to express God's word, you have these programming tools so that you can adapt it to the individual person. You can look at the language they speak, their age, the culture they grew up in, and considering all those factors, you can make your expression change so that person will understand it. And that's really, really the profound power of the new technologies.
So it's not just language. I mean, changing. I mean, the Bible obviously was not written in English originally, but now we have it. It's
right.
It's a multidimensional thing, isn't it?
Absolutely. And you think a good spiritual director does not tell every person he talks to the same thing, as if it were broadcast media. He looks at the person, tries to understand psychologically where they are, the culture they came from, how old they are, and changes what he says based on that. And that's the only way you can effectively share God's word. Is by having that really one-to-one communication. And the new technologies let us do that in an entirely new way, a very profound way. So our whole objective is to make use of that for the church and for humanity.
So it sounds like it's time for a new order, effectively, to come into the world and take advantage, because the older orders are plenty busy doing what they do, and the transformation in media would change them dramatically in ways they weren't set up to do. So now it is time for a new order.
Yeah, and it seems that in some ways there needs to be a fresh approach.
Mm-hmm.
And there are two ways of looking at it. We look at sort of our objectives externally, what we're trying to do with Next Scribe and the Scribes of St. Peter. And it's this attempt to really make use of the technologies as they are, according to their nature, which we talked about. You have to look at the market. You have to do all kinds of fundamental research, long-term research. You need to try to gain audiences so that people will be affected by God's word. It's really a very different approach to media than exists in the church right now. This idea that you want to speak God's word to as many people as possible, and you don't just close in on yourselves. You really have to focus out on people, even people who don't think the church is worthwhile. So it's really this sort of new kind of open focus that God's word is universal. It's the nature of being, the nature of truth, and that's what you're trying to express. Mm-hmm. So there's that new sort of charism that needs to be. On the other end, there's the vocational aspect. And this is something that's been really extraordinary, because there are tremendous numbers of young people and older people too, married and single, who have wonderful talents, technical talents, of course, programming. Had many people, computer science students, but artists and writers, who want to be able to use their talents to serve the church and to serve God. The problem right now is that in the church, there isn't a place where you can use your talents on a world-class level for the faith. And so people who have this vocation to use their gifts to lead others to God, to help others, they have this dilemma. It's mm-hmm. it's either I use my talents fully, which means going into the commercial world, which is, you know, to fulfill their God-given talents, or I do something for the church, mm-hmm. which really doesn't have the same kinds of challenges. I mean, it's just not on the same level creatively.
So if you're not called to the priesthood, or right. necessarily traditional monastic life, or the convent, or something along the teaching, some of the other ministries that are well thought of,
right.
but you still feel a call and you have these talents or you want to develop these talents,
right.
then here's a possible place for you.
Absolutely. I mean, our objective is to provide a place where it's totally focused on love of God and neighbor, but at a world-class level, so you can completely fulfill your God-given talents mm-hmm. in a way that serves others. Mm. So vocationally, that's our obligation, is to really fulfill these vocations in people, because God is calling many people to this. So we're just trying to fulfill that.
Well, I in some ways I like to think that God is calling us to do this show too, so we can showcase these kind of things so that people can find something that they need to find. And I know in my own family, I have cousins who, brother and sister, who never hardly talk to each other, maybe a couple of times a year, until they got on the computer, and now they're emailing each other, you know, weekly.
Oh, yes.
Or very often. So
yes.
There is a community already, in effect, of people who are oriented towards the World Wide Web and emailing each other and communicating that way.
Yes.
And this really will be going out to minister to them as well, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, I think people are really concerned about young people, because in some sense the new technologies are going to have the biggest effect on young people. People are using the web all the time for everything, from schoolwork to entertainment to buying and, you know, buying things. And, you know, one of our concerns, I mean, on the one hand, there's the positive aspect, that we absolutely feel this obligation to speak God's word to people using the digital media. But there's also the negative aspect, that this power of intimate communication that the web gives us is being completely controlled by commercial interests. Mm. And the entire time and attention that people are going to be spending online, as things look now, is completely controlled by commercial interests, trying to make you buy things, to materialize people. And the effect this is going to have is absolutely extraordinary, because you have this incredible power to affect people. And this is why commercial enterprises are so excited about the web, because the power to sell people is just amazing. So what we're trying to do is say, you know, if people are spending most of their time being materialized, that's wrong. On a human level, it's a horrible thing. So what we need to be doing is to be building an online environment where people can be spending their time and attention that engages the whole human person, that's spiritually whole. So that's the positive obligation that we have, or I'm sorry, the negative obligation to, mm-hmm. to counter the commercial interests.
Yeah. Yeah, it is a big effect. I mean, like on television today, if you've got cable, you might be able to get Mother Angelica on EWTN,
right.
who basically is the voice of the Catholic Church, at least in this country. There are a few other exceptions with the Franciscans up in Steubenville and
right.
others like that, but you got to hunt and peck for them. Otherwise, there are a lot of Protestant-inspired groups that are out there.
Yes.
But it's phenomenal to see this movement picking up in the church and utilizing the technology that's there. And I understand the predictions are that at some point in the foreseeable future, mm-hmm. television as we know it, radio, and the World Wide Web are all going to be coming together.
Oh, it'll
they?
Be integrated. Yeah,
it'll be integrated.
A single medium. Yeah. That's right. With
and interactive too.
Oh yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And you know, it'll be focused. You know, I mean, it'll change for individual people, and it'll be a whole different experience of what mass media is. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So your ideas of what you shared with me earlier about how you were going to use it. I mean, in regards to having the flat panels so that people could be. I know on Mother Angelica, you can often see them saying Mass, for instance, or praying the Rosary
right.
There in Alabama. But here, they'll be able to pray with the monks and
right.
do the just like live the life of a monk where they are at home.
Absolutely, and this is there's very profound implications to what we're doing with this, because we'll be putting the flat panels in the chapel, so that the monks, instead of using choir books, will have these large flat panels with the prayers, you know, the psalms that they pray seven times a day. Mm-hmm. But instead of just sort of broadcasting it, you know, we'll take these actual texts that the monks are using and mirror them onto the web, so that someone in Manhattan will be able to pull up the exact text that the monks are using at the time the monks are using it. They'll be able to hear the monks chant the prayers. They'll be able to see through streaming video what's going on in the chapel. And so it'll be a real participation with the monks in their prayer. And this is, you know, this is really radically different than, as you say, like broadcasting a Mass or something, or, mm-hmm. or what Mother Angelica does, where you just sort of sit and watch. I mean, this you'll actually be able to pray with the monks. Mm-hmm. So it has profound implications for community, mm-hmm. because you'll really develop these online communities where even spiritually, the people that you pray with, you know, you'll communicate online with.
So it'd be like chat rooms of a kind, of a different kind. I mean,
yes.
Prayerful chat rooms are people that you can talk to, obtain spiritual direction, or answer questions that you might have just from home or wherever you are. I mean,
that's
your
right.
local library or school.
That's right.
That
yeah.
sort of thing. All right, just in the couple of minutes we've got left, brother, go ahead and make the invitation. Invite the people that you'd like to, you know, let them know that God is, if they're calling them, that they may have a place to come.
Yeah, well, absolutely. I mean, I think if anyone thinks that they have gifts, creative gifts that they want to bring to others, to serve others, and you know they want to exercise those gifts completely in a consecrated way for God and neighbor, then they should talk to us. We're looking for those vocations. We're really hoping that God will bring them to us.
All right. Yes. So if you just tuned in, we've been talking with a two-part interview with Brother Mary Aquinas of Christ in the Desert Monastery, telling us about the new technology being adapted by monasticism and making it available to you. So we want to encourage you to get yourself a pencil or a piece of paper and to write down the information that's going to be coming to you in a few moments. Out of the credits, you'll be able to get their website, both at nextscribe.org, which is the organization that the brother's talking about, or Christ in the Desert, and to find out more information, you'll be able to download that from the web, or it'll also give his phone number as well. You can give him a call and talk to him. But also want to encourage any of those who feel the call to help support this
yes.
organization, because we're talking about being on the ground floor. And the ground floor is a place you might be excited about being and helping develop, or if you feel the call in some way this has inspired you, I encourage you to go ahead and contact him, or at least check in on their website and find out exactly what they have. So I'm just very thankful you had time to come in and visit with us and share this with our friends at home. So on behalf of everyone here at Spirituality Today, I want to thank you for viewing. And again, pay attention to the credits. Drop in on their website and see what they have to say for you, and pray about it and see if the Lord is calling you. And also, if you're a donor out there, consider this as a gift for God. So on behalf of everyone, this is Bill O'Donnell. Thank you for viewing, and stay tuned next week for another segment on spirituality.